deacon's meeting, so we'll go ahead and make that in that too. But the main point of us coming together is just simply we're going to spend some time in prayer about the situation in our church, in our community, in our state, our country. Share some of those concerns and just be praying together on it. If you are unable to join us, which I know multiples are, that's quite all right. I understand. There's no important business as far as that we have to get done or discuss on it. But if you would just spend some time in prayer where you are, I don't know any other way of saying it. This is a time that's unprecedented, and it's going to take men and women of God on their knees. I do want to make the announcement. I applaud him. I actually really am grateful. I did not believe the news when I heard it from a friend, but Governor Edwards has actually called for 3 days of fasting and praying. I went and checked. I was like, really? A politician? Wow, this is going to be cool. It has been a request to fast during the lunch hour or for lunch Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday of this week. I've never been one to really promote the big, hey, let's all fast together. But yet at the same time, I look at this one and I'm so honored. I personally am going to join it. And I'm going to ask us as a church, not asking you to necessarily join that fast. I'm asking you to pray. Seriously, we need to pray. It's not going to make a change in the sense that if you pray or you don't pray, God cares or doesn't care. Okay? But God told us to petition Him in prayer, to bring our needs to the throne. And we need to be obedient, and God will be faithful. Amen? Amen. Amen. Are there any other announcements? We have officially postponed, I guess indefinitely, the garage sale again. We will take your stuff in. If you've got that and you need to get it out to us, we'll be happy to. We'll try and call some youth and families together to start moving some of the stuff around. And we're now, we don't know if or when we will be able to pull it off this season. We were trying to get it done before school started because that is the request from our community. Not within our church, but from the community itself. However, just not positive that's going to happen. So right now, we're just going to put that back in storage in the building behind Parker's house and in the garage there. So if there's any other announcements, yes. Thank you. I do. Louis Dole passed away yesterday morning. The services, thank you for reminding me, the services are visitation is at 9 and the funeral is at 10. What I don't know, and I did not get in the text, was the location of the funeral. I understand that it will be at Union, that they will be coming back. When they said back, I'm assuming that meant they were going to be coming back there after the burial. So I'm getting a nod. The service will be held at Union. So 9 o'clock visitation and a 10 o'clock funeral.
What
day? Tomorrow. I'm so sorry. Yes, that's Monday, tomorrow. All right. God bless. Let's get started with our service this morning. Father, Lord, thank you. You have blessed us immensely, and we know that you will be faithful to continue with those blessings. We ask, Lord, this morning that you will just, Lord, accept our time of worship. Allow it to rise to your throne like a sweet-smelling incense as we lift our voices up to you. Amen.
Amen. Good to see you. Come on, let's stand as we begin our worship. This is God. What a wonderful, wonderful.
Thank you.
seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay. This is one of my favorite passages. Quentin, you read me my Bible? I can't read it if I don't have a Bible with me. So I'll go ahead and show you my visuals. You might can guess what verses we're going to read. You see a difference in these two branches? Which one do you want to be? Thanks, buddy. All right, we're going to read from John 15, 1 through 8. It says, I am the true vine. This is Jesus talking. I am the true vine. My Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch of mine that does not produce fruit, and he trims and cleans every branch that produces fruit, so it will produce even more fruit. Did y'all catch that? Whether you're this vine or this vine, you're getting cut. You are already clean because of the words I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. A branch cannot produce fruit alone, but must remain in the vine. In the same way, you cannot produce fruit alone, but must remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. If any remain in me, and I remain in them, they will produce much fruit. But without me, they can do nothing. If any do not remain in me, they are like a branch that is thrown away and then dies. People pick up dead branches, then throw them into the fire and burn them. If you remain in me and follow my teachings, you can ask anything you want and it will be given to you. You should produce much fruit and show that you are my followers, which brings glory to my Father. I actually got this one out of the burn pile this morning in my backyard, and that's why it's dead and doesn't have any leaves on it. And then this one, I couldn't bring the whole plant with me, but I just pulled it from the plant in the front this morning. So it's still nice and green and got leaves on it because it was connected. Now, out in my garden right now, I've got some watermelons and pumpkins going on. And they keep, you know, they grow, and then they have these little tendrils that grab onto stuff to anchor themselves, and they grow some more, and they grab onto something else. And I keep having to go out there and, like, no, don't grab onto that. No, don't grab onto that. Go this way. And it just kind of reminded me when I was reading these verses, how many times in life do we grab onto something we shouldn't? What are you grabbing onto now that you need to be moved over back to where you're going? You're still connected. You're still getting nutrients, but you're reaching forward. You're reaching out for something that's not in our best interest. So I think y'all understand how this works pretty well. Jesus says he was like the vine and we were like the branches. He wants us to see how important it is to stay connected and to understand we would wither and dry up if we broke off away from him, just like this poor little branch. And I think we all want to be like this healthy branch that's getting water and nutrients from the vine and staying healthy. And if it was a grapevine, which it's not, but if it was, then it would eventually produce grapes. Can we pray? Dear Lord, Jesus said he is the vine and we are the branches. Help us to be like this healthy branch and be connected closely to Jesus the vine. Thank you that all of our lives will produce fruit as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Beth. Our next song is one straight out of the hymn book, and it's called God Be the Glory, or Praise the Lord. Let's stand up again as we sing this particular hymn. Would you please? may be seated. As we continue our worship this morning, this next song is one of my favorites, and we sing it every once in a while. It's called I Think About What God Does For Us Each and Every Day, each moment in our life. He defends us, and He defends us because of the love that He has for us. So that brings peace and comfort and even joy, even in tumultuous times that we might find ourselves in today. We know that God is in control, and He loves you and I very dearly. And that defense is what causes us to be able to stand even in the face of an enemy. Sing this with me. Little snippet of a song. We've done it before, but it's says sweet shalom, and we know that the word shalom means peace. And if there's a time in our lives with all the things that's going on, this is a time that we need a peace that passes all understanding, trusting God. Sing this with me. It's called Sweet Shalom. Control, and we can trust you. We know that you love us dearly, and we thank you for that. God, we just ask for your protection, for your guidance, for your wisdom. We ask it, Lord, for our families, for our church, for our state, for our nation, for this world. God, just be with each of our leaders. Guide them. Give them wisdom, Lord, as they seek it from you. God, bless each one that's here this morning. Thank you for the opportunity. Bless your word. And may it truly bring peace and comfort to our hearts and to our minds as we realize just who you are and how much you really do love us. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Glenn, when we were practicing the song, Your Love Defends Me, I just enjoyed playing it and singing it. When we came up this morning, sang that song, I realized how much of a prayer and a rejoicing of thankfulness, gratefulness, that God is defending us. That we are truly not in a real danger physically, spiritually, emotionally, financially. That God is still in complete control. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Teachers, I have a blessing for you this morning. I actually have a copy of Jesus' report card. Okay, I really don't. This one came out of the Reader's Digest, but it was so funny I thought I would share it with you. It's student, J. Period Christ, in grade 10, okay? So this is Jesus as a sophomore in high school. In English, he makes a C, comments, tends to write in archaic forms, saith, maketh, etc., and relies overly on outmoded figures of speech. In history, makes a B, excellent and enthusiastic pupil of ancient history, but is baffled by the modern era. Aren't we all? In earth science, he gets an incomplete, totally misunderstanding one of the major assignments, to give a report on the age of rocks, and instead reported on the rock of ages, needs to repeat. Physical education, D. He is a troublemaker, During one of our units on swimming, he refused to work on technique and instead just walked across the pool. General concerns, though he is a charismatic boy, social problems seem to persist. And the most disturbing is that he recently has organized a gang of 12 of his peers and also should keep his hair at a more tidy length and stop wearing sandals in accordance to the school uniform guidelines. It's funny, but let's just be honest. If Jesus were to be here today, would he be accepted? No. Would he be acceptable? Would he be accepted in the church? And I ask, and I think to some extent, the answer would have to be no. I get at least a nod on that. I mean, he hangs out with the wrong kind of people. Now you joke about his hair and his sandals, but Jesus actually dressed like a good Jewish boy. He did. He looked the normal today, but he also wasn't a person that everybody just looked at and saw, man, he's just a great looking guy. Instead, he was a fellow that kind of hung out with the wrong crowd, said the wrong things to the wrong people. And I think today we could really just kind of accept the fact that if Jesus were here today, he just would not necessarily be acceptable. He might get one interview on CNN, but he wouldn't get a second. You hear what I'm saying? I actually have one of my favorite pastors named by the guy named guys Vody Balcom, and I was really impressed. Somebody sent me a text a few years back. He was on CNN, like the news, and they were interviewing him on the news, and he gave information afterwards that they informed him when he left, "Thank you so much for coming. You will not be coming back." Why? Because he said exactly what he felt like he needed to say. One way or the other, I'm like, well, everybody else does that and gets away with it. He did it once, and they asked him to leave. It's just an acceptable thing that you can be tolerant to every view out there except one of Christianity. And that's just kind of the norm. Have y'all noticed it's getting a little worse? That's why I was really kind of shocked that our governor called for a fast and pray. I think it's a wonderful thing. I understand his Catholic heritage there and maybe definitely even pleasing those around him. And he definitely earned a little bit more of my, I don't know what you call that, respect. He got my attention with it. I think that's absolutely wonderful. But I don't think that really did him a great job for getting him into any other political position. It's not exactly something that the world looks up to. Here's the thing that I would encourage you is that there's a good chance that your Christian views today, the way you are being treated in the country and politics and the news and the world today, enjoy it. Soak it in. It's probably not going to get any better. You say, well, that's a very pessimistic view. It's a very biblical view. In fact, the Bible tells us that if you're going to truly be a follower of Christ, you should kind of expect it, right? Now, in that same chapter that Beth was reading out of this morning, in John chapter 15, well, the same book, a little bit farther down. In John chapter 15, if you want to turn to your Bibles there, I promise we're going to kind of bounce around a little bit in that section. But we're going to be in the book of John around chapter 15 all morning. In John chapter 15, starting in verse 18, Jesus encourages us. He says, "If the world hates you, understand it hated me before it hated you." Just let that kind of sink on you for just a minute, all right? If the world hates you, know that it hated me before it hated you. So the title of today's sermon is "They Hated Me First." Have y'all ever heard that with kids? Well, he hit me first. You know, I really don't give a flip who started it. At this point, everybody's out of line. And Jesus looks at it and he says, look, you just need to know how to front it. If they hate you, they're going to hate. They hated me first. In fact, he even goes on with another line and it says this, that a slave shouldn't be, know what? Can't be any greater than his master. And the way he is saying here, he's actually saying, look,
they're not going to treat you better than they treated me. If you're truly following Christ, you're speaking like He speaks. You're acting like He acts. You're saying the things that He says. Then you should expect, to some extent, to get the same retort that He got. And if they hated you for it, then know that they hated Him first. If you were of the world would love you as its own. However, because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of it, the world hates you. Remember the word I spoke to you. A slave is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. I'll give you my translation of that. This really shouldn't shock you. I think what does shock us sometimes is our own attitude about it. I'm guilty of this. I kind of grew up in the deep Bible Belt South. I kind of expect people to respect my Christian views. I just kind of do. I know that that's not something that they're required to do. I just kind of somehow feel like, well, you know, this is a Christian country, and this is God's country, and you're gonna be here. You're just gonna have to put up with that. You know what I'm finding out? No, they really don't, do they? I think we have that here in the South. We still, especially here in Tensaw, we still get it pretty good, right? I mean, we still have a fairly decent amount of respect for it, but it is waning quickly. We want people to love us in return for loving them. God says love people. We expect that when we love people, that people are going to love you back. You expect that if you show people the love of Jesus, that they're going to love Jesus like you love Jesus. At least that's the expectation. That's the heart desire. I remember taking a group of kids to Birmingham, Alabama. We were in Birmingham, Alabama, and we went over a Thanksgiving holiday. We were there the weekend before, and this ministry that we were joining had vowed to feed all of the homeless of Birmingham, Alabama, a full Thanksgiving dinner. I mean, the whole works. It was turkey, ham, it was all the fixings, everything was there. And they had churches from all over Alabama bringing in just trays and trays and trays of dishes. And most of what we did was just help haul the food around and get it in spot. But they allowed us to take some of our kids at a time and go get in the serving line. The serving line was probably 100 yards long. And it had like 5 or 6 entry points where people would go through and they'd get their full deals on a big Chinette plate. Y'all know what I'm talking about? The Thanksgiving plate?
Yeah.
And it wasn't, no, it was a good plate. And it was piled up with food, or it had even one of those little dome over things. And it was just, oh, it was good food. And I remember putting our kids in the lineup. And as people came through the line, they'd cuss them. And they'd holler at them. And they'd call them horrible names. They called our little girl some of the things that, I'll tell you, I'd have decked them through the nose on any other situation that you talked to one of my girls that way. And I sat back there and kind of bit my lip and just kind of held our ground. Because they wanted an extra piece of ham. Or they wanted them to leave all the signs up and just pile it all up with dressing. And the little girls had been given specific instructions. And they were following along. And I'm telling you, they ripped those people up one side and down the other. And I told myself, I said, no, I'm not going to save these kids. I'm not going to pull them. I'm not going to put them in another room where they don't have to see the ugly. Just because you're showing the love of God doesn't mean people won't love you in return. Just because you're doing it right doesn't mean that they're going to love you in return. And the lesson I remember teaching those kids that week was, don't get mad at the world for acting worldly. When a lost person acts lost, they're just fulfilling their job description. Can I preach to you this morning the same message that those little girls learned the hard way? Stop getting mad at the world for acting worldly. They're just fulfilling their job description. If you want to be angry at the church for not acting godly. John 15. Y'all would. We're going to back up and get back to that verse. Think in order to really grasp what God is trying to tell us in verse 18. I think we need to back up to verse 1 and start getting into the conversation. I'm going to read right now John chapter 15, verse 1 through verse 8. Now I am the true vine, and my Father is the vineyard keeper. Every branch in me that does not produce fruit, he removes. He prunes every branch that does produce fruit so that it will produce more fruit. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me and I in you, just as the branch is unable to produce fruit by itself unless it remains in the vine, so neither you can unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. The one who remains in me and I in him produces much fruit, because you can do nothing without me. If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown aside like a branch and it withers. And they gather them and they throw them into the fire and they are burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you want and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you produce much fruit and prove to be my disciples. All right, so here is that broken down in a nutshell. I'm the vine, you're in the branches. Know your place in the flow of things. Know your place in the flow of things spiritually. We get a little out of line here every now and then, okay? How many of y'all are guilty? Please don't, you have to raise your hand. Just kind of nod loudly. That you are guilty in just the last week. The majority of the time that you prayed, you were asking God to do something for you. I didn't say that was bad. I said that wasn't the majority of what you have prayed for. God, do this for them, do this for me. Understand your place in the flow of things. The vine doesn't tell the root what to do. It's the other way around. But yet all the blessings do seem to flow one way, don't they? God loved Jesus. God sent Jesus. God empowered Jesus. And then God sacrificed Jesus for the salvation of others and for the glory of God. Now don't get confused with that. That doesn't mean that God holds you in higher esteem than he does Christ. Christ is still the center of all creation. He's the firstborn of creation. It's all his. He's the name above all names. And he is our Lord, our Savior. He's the center. And yet at the same time, God chose to sacrifice him for the sake of you and for others, because it's the sacrificial love of Christ that brought into us the salvation that we so desperately needed. So even though God loves Jesus, sent Jesus, empowered Jesus, he did choose to sacrifice Jesus. Jesus loves you. Jesus sent you. Jesus has empowered you. And Jesus, to some extent, will sacrifice you in the sense of your life, your struggles, your victories, your defeats, and yes, even your death. We don't really see that as a major threat, do we? And yet people around the world today will be killed for being professing Christians. And God uses it every day to save others and to bring glory to God. Know your place in the lineup and the flow of things. And remember this. You signed up for it. You did, right?
Yeah.
You signed up for it. You came out. Maybe you didn't completely understand the whole thing as you got into it. Honestly, we don't completely understand it. things. You get the good and the bad, and you did sign up for it. What would should shock us more than anything else is not that the world might treat you poorly for it, for they treated Jesus poorly. What should shock you is that so many of us don't look enough like him, act like enough like him, or speak enough like him for the world to really give a flip what you're doing. That should be a little shocking. That we really just aren't necessarily living a life that requires any real attack. Yet when the attack comes, and it's come, right? I mean, it's here. We've seen the real attack. We know it's coming harder. How many of y'all just thinking in your head right now that, you know what, if no matter which way the election goes, there's going to be more riots? Anybody kind of nod that one? That's really not all that shocking. There's probably going to be a little more rough times in the future before we get to better times, if we get to better times. I'm not a doomsdayist. I'm sorry, I'm still a glass half full kind of guy. I'm still saying, and I'm still going to keep preaching, and I'm probably going to preach it till I die, that I believe that all of this is for the sake of the glory of God, and it's not only going to be glory in the long run, it's going to be glory in the time that I get to see it. I believe there's a great revival coming. I believe it's already started, it's already happening, it's happening to the people all across the world, not just right here. I believe the Church of Jesus Christ is going to explode out of this, because the greatest persecution has always been the greatest growth. It always has. Every time you look in history and the world put its boot heel on the throat of the church exploded and did better than it ever did. So by all means, if the persecution comes, man, I'm sorry, I'm just going to have to look at it and say, I'm going to count on the fact that it's going to be glorious on the other side of it. I'm hoping that I get to see it. Let me keep reading here. I'm going to read, start in verse 9. It says, as the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have spoken these things to you so that my joy may be made in you and your joy may be complete. This is my command, love one another as I have loved you, for no greater love than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. Jesus already paid the price. And I did all this, and I'm telling you, all of this stuff that's going on is so that God's joy through the sacrificial love of Jesus Christ can be implanted in your heart and your joy can be made complete. Oh, the joy of Jesus Christ is not something that we should forget about. We were talking earlier about that downward spiral of negativity. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Anybody been kind of fasting from the media a little bit? Boy, it just leaves a bad taste in your mouth, doesn't it? Oh, that conversation with people, and it does. It'll just kind of, my dad told me the other day, he says, whew, we just got to change conversations. Let's talk about something we all like. It wasn't because he just hated talking about it. It's like, man, we just talked about it enough. Let the joy of Jesus Christ, think on these things. Let the things of God fill your life and then dish them back out to the people around you so that they're getting a dose of some good stuff too. See, God says when you abide in me, when you stay in me like a vine, he says, you're going to produce fruit. In fact, it says you're going to produce much fruit. I think sometimes we complain and we whine because we don't see the fruit. But it says you're going to produce much fruit. Sometimes you just can't spot it on the vine. I saw my wife do something this week I never heard anybody do. And this is love, folks. Okay? You got to truly love to do this. She untangled watermelon vines. She did it. Gently untangled the watermelon vines. There was so much stuff there that the bees couldn't get down and get to the flowers. So Beth untangled the watermelon vines. I was like, goodness gracious, isn't there an app for that? But then when she started moving around, I saw something that was really, really neat. I saw the smallest watermelon I've ever seen. He about that big. And Beth went over to that watermelon, and she went down just a little bit farther, and she snipped off that part of the vine so that everything just focus on him. And she made him a nice little nest so that he can make much fruit. Just like God says, he said, look, for those that don't produce fruit, I cut those vines off, I throw them away. For those of you who are producing fruit, I'm going to prune you. That don't sound fun. I'm going to prune you so that you can make more fruit. Lord's been pulling some suckers off of me, for those of y'all who are tomato growers. Lord's been snipping suckers on me, and I want to just tell you that it's a glorious thing to trust in God and allow the flow of His love to come into your life. Because you know what it does? It produces fruit, and that fruit is what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. Man, I get those. They're all good. I can use a little more patience right now. I don't want to pray for it, but I know that if I abide in Him, that the fruits of the Spirit will grow in my life, that the love will grow in my life. And it's what? It's made to bless the whole world around us. Bear it out in your life. Enjoy the fruit of God. Then if, that's where we pick back up to the verse we started on. It's a better place to start from, isn't it? If the world hates you, no, they hated me first. And I've already beat the world. Folks, I read the end of the book. We win. It's really good. I don't know how good heaven is. I've got my mindset that it's got to have some really good food in it, because it said there's a buffet table, a banquet table. I'm pretty sure there's potluck in heaven and the angels bring the angel food cake. I don't know what all is going to be there, but I'm pretty excited about the food that's there. I'm excited about the crystal sea. I want to go surfing with St. Peter. I hear he doesn't even use a board. I want to see the people that I love there. But at the same time, I want to walk up and actually get to sing the song, "Hold Me, Jesus," with Jesus holding me. I want to know that there's no more pain, there's no more tears, and that God Himself forever and ever is going to hold me, and that a little bit of fruit I couldn't see happening in the world around me gets to come out and say, He says, look, I didn't do it because of you, I just happened to do it through you. It was worth it. You can take a whooping when it's worth it. So, okay, yeah. It might be time to take a little bit. And God says, hey, if they hate you, know they hated me first. And know this. The price that you pay will be far outweighed by the blessings that follow. Amen? Amen. I don't know. Now I've got the song in my head, Victory in Jesus. Folks, that's the message. That is the attitude that we need to somehow tap back into. And we need to tap into it so much that the world around you sees the light of Jesus Christ in your life. Maybe try that one. Walk into Max Fresh Market singing Victory in Jesus. And one thing I will remind you, there's a lady behind the counter that will sing with you. There's one. I don't know if all of them will, but there's one lady there. You come in singing Victory in Jesus, and y'all can get all verses out before she ever quits. Let's have that impact on the world today. I love y'all. I love you so much. Let's pray and let's ask God to bless us and to give us the courage and strength to go out and do just that. I know He will. Abide in me and I in you. Alright, He promises He will. We just need to abide in Him. Father, Lord, thank You for the fruit that You are producing in our life today. Thank You for the world around us that is being impacted by our words, our hearts, our love, Lord, our testimonies, our songs. Lord, thank You that we are being able to produce fruit in a way that the world around us is changed forever by it. Lord, thank You. I don't always see it, but I know it's there because You promised it's there. Oh, Lord, give us the strength, give us the courage to meet the world in victory today. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Come on, let's stand.
Stand up.
Sing that chorus with me.
We also have a Wednesday night Bible study going on at 6 o'clock, and I'm going to go ahead and give you a heads up in a few weeks, and we'll start one on Sunday night. So if Wednesday night's not good for you, in a few weeks, and we'll start one on Sunday night. God bless. Y'all go. Shine a light so bright that the world around you sees Jesus.